On January 17, 1997, Dr. J. Bernard of the Aerospace Company called his insurance adjuster. Skeptical, the agent could not believe what the doctor was telling him. His car had been hit by a rocket. That afternoon, the Delta II rocket, with a nearly perfect history of satellite launches, had lifted off from Cape Canaveral, carrying the first GPS-2R satellite to modernize the current network. But within 13 seconds of taking off, the entire spacecraft exploded in midair, igniting a dangerous rain of rubble that fell all over the surroundings of the Air Force base, even setting several parked cars on fire. The impressive footage on the news was enough to prove Dr. Bernard's case. A significant improvement. The first ever GPS satellite was launched in 1978, and a very dependable launch vehicle was created over a decade later. First launched on February 14, 1989, the Delta II rocket was lifted off from Cape Canaveral, Florida, carrying the initial GPS Block 2 satellite. As stated by Air Force officials, the system was a significant improvement over previous designs, requiring a specific launch window for each orbital position. The expendable launch system was built by McDonnell Douglas with the involvement of the Aerospace Company in the development and integration of their precious cargo of GPS satellites. As CNN described at the time, quote, "The rocket was carrying the first in a new generation of global positioning system satellites that can enable people to pinpoint time to within a millionth of a second, speed to a fraction of a mile per hour, and location to within a few feet." During its career, the spacecraft had a 99% success rate, effectively positioning the Delta II among the most reliable launch vehicles, despite two significant failures. Failures. On August 5, 1995, Delta II launched from Cape Canaveral Air Force Station, loaded with a KoreaSat-1 satellite. The launch went smoothly, but a solid rocket motor did not separate correctly. As a result, the vehicle entered orbit too slowly and caused problems when reaching its correct trajectory and ultimate orbit. While it eventually managed to position itself in the right orbit, the spacecraft had to use extra fuel, which considerably shortened its operational life. Then, a year and a half later, the launch vehicle would be involved in an accident that far surpassed that first minor setback. On January 17, 1997, the launch vehicle was intended to carry the new generation of Air Force satellites into orbit, GPS-2R1, or GPS-SVN-42, the first satellite of the Block 2R production. GPS-2R1 was loaded on the unmanned Delta II 7925 9.5 launch vehicle, serial number D241. The launch was set to take place from Launch Complex 17A at the Cape Canaveral Air Force Station, or CCAFS. But as the rocket took off at 4:28 p.m. Universal Time, something quickly went wrong, and the world was watching. Precipitation. Within 13 seconds of liftoff, Delta II blew up, and with it, $40 million worth of navigational satellite technology, in addition to the $55 million rocket. Air Force officials reported that the rocket actually self-destructed after an anomaly 10 seconds into the flight, with a warning soon coming through the loudspeakers in the facility, quote, "Take cover immediately from falling debris. I'll say again, take cover immediately from falling debris." As captured on camera, the explosion turned into a rain of millions of pieces falling back to the ground. Debris soon covered the Air Force Station and even reached the Atlantic Ocean. Some of it landed around the launch pad, igniting a small fire, while others fell into the parking lot outside the complex blockhouse. The rubble destroyed at least 20 cars and vehicles. In total, 215 tons of debris fell within 3,000 feet of the launch pad alone, not including the bits that made their way to the nearby grounds belonging to the Air Force Space and Missile Museum. The authorities advised the personnel to stay inside with the windows closed and even the air conditioning systems turned off as a precautionary measure. Even though the air service affirmed the smoke wasn't toxic, an official at the Brevard County Emergency Operations Center clarified that vapors could be irritating and harmful to humans and animals. Moreover, the explosion was reportedly felt as far as 25 miles away and even damaged some windows within 10 miles. Meanwhile, sheriff's deputies warned residents in and around the area to also remain inside, taking all the necessary precautions to avoid breathing the fuel fumes. They saw the rain of fire lighting up the Florida sky from the safety of their homes. Rocket science. In further investigations, it was concluded that it was the rocket's onboard computer that activated the flight termination system. The signal then detonated the explosive charges aboard the spacecraft, causing the succeeding blast. Still, the redundant inertial flight control assembly, or RIFCA, part of the avionics upgrades the rocket had received, managed to survive the outburst. The system landed safely on the beach and was promptly recovered and returned to the manufacturer. When the inertial sensor assembly was reinstalled into new housing and powered up, Dr. Bernard gleefully expressed, quote, "The RIFCA performed flawlessly. Once again, a tribute to all who designed and built this powerful guidance system." Unfortunately, the rocket did not work as expected. Later investigations determined that there was a crack in the casing of a solid rocket motor, leading to the failure. The problem started at T plus 6 seconds and expanding rapidly. 6 seconds after that, the solid rocket booster, or SRB casing, ruptured, unleashing a chain of events. Several pieces fell apart and struck the solid rocket booster next to the motor, ultimately damaging it. Then, 13 seconds into the flight, the safety destruct charges activated and the rocket auto-terminated. As a result, the first stage and the remaining SRBs were detonated. The upper stages were thus freed and blasted into the air, and at T plus 21 seconds, the range safety officer manually destroyed the upper stages for safety purposes, sending the termination command. The rocket's remaining part was ripped into pieces. Meanwhile, the GPS satellite and payload shroud managed to survive the flames, but were lost upon impact with the ground. It was never fully determined what exactly triggered the automatic destruct system, with potential causes being a pulled lanyard, a shockwave from the ruptured SRB, or even the heat. Nevertheless, it was found that support from a new transportation system that had been recently introduced excessively pressured and damaged the booster. The system was revised after the disastrous launch, and a new ultrasound inspection of the boosters was put in place for future flights. The end of an era. When the rocket exploded, it was merely 1,610 feet above the complex, making it the lowest altitude launch failure at Cape Canaveral as far back as the 1965 Atlas Centaur AC-5. The subsequent Delta II launches were postponed after the accident until the cause of failure was thoroughly investigated, and more importantly, corrective action was taken. Still, the launch vehicle returned to service on May 5, 1997, and made a successful comeback. During the following decades, the Delta II launched NASA probes to Mars and Mercury, as well as to the Moon and several asteroids. In addition, it conveyed into orbit 48 GPS navigation satellites all the way through 2009, not to mention commercial satellites for companies like Iridium and Globalstar. Then, in 2018, the Delta II rocket completed its final flight, the 155th in the vehicle's history and the 100th consecutive successful one, an event the Aerospace Company called, quote, "the end of an era." Thank you for watching our video. If you enjoy military history, don't hesitate to subscribe to all of our Dark Documentaries channels for more exciting real-life stories. And hit the bell icon to be notified of our newest content, which we publish regularly. Stay tuned.